ओके सर इट्स फाइन।
196 सो
ओके वी कैन स्टार्ट द सेशन।
ओके सो ओके
ओके थैंक्स।
ओके सो आई थिंक आई जस्ट कंटिन्यू। ओके सो वी स्टॉप्ड एट गेटिंग फिट। सो यू कैन ऑलवेज इम्प्रूव बाई डूइंग मोर रिफाइनमेंट। सो एनी टाइम यू वॉन्ट यू कैन डू मोर रिफाइनमेंट। ओके सो यू कैन डू लॉट ऑफ यू कैन प्ले विथ दिस ओनली प्रोवाइडेड यू हैव टू know what you are trying, what you are refining. Okay, because don't try to refine too many things, then it may not give any physical meaning for that. Okay, okay. Madam, can you start recording?
Okay, sir, it will start soon.
One second. Okay, so. So what once you get some decent fit, for instance, like the one we got it in this case, so what you can do is you can extract a lot of information from this fit. Okay, so these are the outputs. What are the general outputs? So those things you can extract based on your fitting. Okay. So for this, what you are supposed to do, you just go to the last column in your EDP PCR. Okay, go to click output, and you can see so many things. Okay, so first thing one thing you can do is you can get a crystallographic CIF, crystallographic information file for the fitted data, not like the starting model, but this is the crystallographic information file which you will get it for your sample. Okay, so this will be used to do the plotting. Okay, crystallographic crystal structure plotting, which I'm going to show you. Okay, then you can also do some you can also extract from more information, especially like if you want to take calculated observed integrated intensity, so you can take it in a separate file. And there is one more file which is called as SUM, okay, summary parameter file. You can you can have this file also just by clicking here. Okay, so apart from that, there are so many other things which I may not be able to explain one class. So what are the other things which will be important is for instance, if you want to do some if you go to reflection file, you can select the first one. So if you select the first one, you will get information about the HKL, multiplicity, D spacing, 2 theta, FWHM, then this is your intensity observed, intensity your calculated. Okay, so then also you'll get the difference for each peak. So this will be important for calculating some stress strain and the size, crystallized size. So either you can select this or select the second one. Okay, so you, once you get very good or decent fit, then what you can do, go to this out. Okay, go to out, select the SIF file, select some file, then go to your HKL reflection, select the first one. You can also have the G Fourier, so I will show one G Fourier. Okay, and also you can also get something called as a calculated profile, which is your SUB. That means for each profile, if you have more than one phase, then what happens, you can also extract each profile for each phase. For example, if I have three different phases, this black one, whatever you are seeing, this is for the entire pattern. Okay, so it is single peak. Instead of that, if I have two three phases, I can also generate calculated profile for each phase. Okay, so this this will be useful if you want to show in your publication or thesis. Okay, So then by default you have PRF. This is, if it is active, then only you can open this PRF. If it is not active, then you cannot open. Okay. So these are the things what I'm selecting. So now what I will do is I will select these things. So I selected WinPlotter, which is already there. I will select HKL with FWHM, and also I have plotted. I have selected some file. Okay, SUM file. So let us see now what you can get. Okay, so if I'm going to save this, and I'm going to open that file. This is the. So if you see the ritual, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, only five files are there right now. So now what I will do, I am going to run this program with all the selected output files. So it is going to run the same fitting. Okay, so I think, 14.3, so it's fine. So now what you do is, if you come back here, you can see it is the number of files has increased. Okay, for your CO2 ritual, and you can see here you have something called as CO2 ritual with crystallographic information file. So this file you can use it for drawing your crystal structure. So I am going to show these two things. One is your Fourier, and other one is your SIF file. Okay. So for doing this. Okay, so I think if you want to open this now, as you can see in the output file, I wanted SIF file, which is your crystallographic information file. So I can see once I run this, I have this crystallographic information file, then SUM file, which is SUM file, is here. Okay. So then you can also have your out file. Okay. In your output file, HKL file, I have selected also to write, I have asked the program to write the final HKL along with FWHM and calculated intensity. Okay. So all these things will be written here. And also I have asked the program to write the G Fourier. Okay. So this is already written here in the FOU, okay, Fourier form. So now what you do is, once you save this and run this, then they are already sitting there. So I'll just do it again. Okay, so if you go back, you can see at 235, it has been again rewritten. Okay, so now what I will do, I will go to something called as Vesta. Okay, so this you have to download and you can install it. So you can run it from here, or you can run it from your Windows button. Okay, so you just locate where is the Vesta, and then you can try to run it. Okay, or you have to just do the. So let me see. So if I click here, let me see if it can work. No, it's not working. Okay. Then I don't have Vesta in my computer. Okay. So instead of Vesta, there's one more thing is your Filmproof Studio. So if I click this, then again, one more window will open. So this is your Filmproof Studio. So I can go here, open file, and I can go directly to the assignment one, which is on my desktop, and I can try to open the CO2 ritual, this is the one which we just created, and I open it. Okay. So if I open, you can see these are the, this is your crystal structure from your refinement. So these things, again, you can control how to do the, how to get a octahedral, or polyhedral, all those things. So, but anyhow, I'm not going in detail with this. Okay, so you can use either Foolproof for Studio, or you can also, if you have installed the Vesta, so then you can also use Vesta. Vesta gives better images compared to your compared to this Foolproof Studio. Okay, then the other one is your Fourier transform. So if you go here, there is something called as G Fourier. So if I go here for G Fourier, and then again same thing, if I go here, click this and go back to desktop with assignment one where I've saved, it is already giving the CO2 ritual. Okay, so if I open this, and then I have to just do this calculation. Okay, so it will take one minute or something like that. So once it is running, so you can see you get this kind of plots. Okay, so these are the plots that you can obtain from your ritual refinement. Okay, so this is a GDF Fourier transform. So this is again with respect to x by a and y by b. So you can, if you click here, you can, it will change different layers. Okay, so if you take one single unit cell, so you are literally moving from one end to other end of the unit cell. So these things you can see, like somewhere you can have your oxygen, and then you see the zirconia, because we gave this is a zirconium dope sample. Okay, so that is why it is showing zirconia. Okay, and then this is you have oxygen, and then all these things. Okay, so this is how you can also do the you can also calculate the G Fourier from the refinement. So so these are two things that will be useful, and also you'll also have something called as bond strength. So for this I will make a tutorial, and I'll give you, okay, so what you can extract. So apart from that, you can also have HKL, you can also generate HKL and all these things. So I will show you what are there in these OU2 file. So if you go to out file, then you can see here it is giving all the possible positions and then intensity and those things. Okay, so you can also see in the end you'll have your BISO and your occupancy XYZ, all these things. Okay, so this is also important in the context of if you want to report something, then you can do. Okay, so then one more thing which is more useful would be like these things. Okay, so you can also see the observed and calculate what is the difference here with respect to each peak. Okay, so all these things will be there in these kind of files. Okay, so I think with this I will try to what else, just a minute. So let me see what is there in the HKL. Okay, so for opening them, you can just open it in Notepad. Okay, so in HKL file, again you can have all this information. So this is your D spacing for each peak. This is a 2 theta. This is your full width half maximum. So this full width half maximum can be used to calculate the your crystallite size and your strain. Okay, so this, which I'm going to explain. Okay. Okay, so we'll come back here. So full pattern fitting. So we have done two different types of full pattern fitting till now. The first one was the one which was for Libbe fittings, which is your profile fitting. So in case of profile fitting, you get information about the lattice parameter and also the symmetry of the space group or the space group. So, but if you want to get more information or more useful information, then you should go for ritual method, which is where in which case you have to give the atomic positions, okay, or the Wyckoff positions. You introduce the Wyckoff or atomic positions in your profile fitting, and then you try to refine the atomic position, your thermal BISO, and also your occupancy. So in that case, you are going to model the complete crystal structure from your observed peaks. Okay, with the peaks position and peak intensity, you are going to model a complete crystal structure. Okay, so this is your ritual refinement. There is more than that. You can also get a crystalline size, microstrain, and preferred orientation, which you can also model by ritual refinement. But for right now, I think we are going to just stop here, because this will be much higher end. So what I will show you next is how do you say your fitting is good? So this is just like this is one of the example. Okay, how many parameters does it takes to fit an element? Okay, if I want to get a really good proper shape of an elephant from arbitrary circles, so how many parameters you are using to fit? So in the first case, I am using only 5 parameters. So I will see something like this. I don't know. Maybe this is like this. Maybe amoeba or something. We don't know whether it is elephant or amoeba. Okay. So then you increase your number of fittings from 5 to 8. Then you start seeing something, but we don't know again this is whether it is elephant or a dog. Okay, so I'll increase the number of fitting parameters. Okay, like from 8 I'm going to go to 11. So if I have 11, so I can see now there is a trunk here, there's some kind of mouth. I can also see the tail. Okay, if I further increase, so then what happens? I can clearly start seeing this the features of an elephant. So this is the same thing with respect to ritual refinement. Okay, so if you know more information about your sample, like in case of your composition, it can in case of your strain that your parameter fitting in the sense, you can I have used only XYZ BISO for an instance in our case, but you can also do more than that. You can also do some preferred orientation. You can do lot of other things, which is your advanced modeling. So then you can get much more in-depth information about your sample. Okay, so more than just crystal structure, you can also get stress, strain, all those things. Okay, so for this is some of the things which I'm going to try to cover here. Okay, so more than just phase quantification. Phase quantification is how many phases are there, and then crystal structure. So what are the other information that you can derive from XRD? Okay, so there are so many things. I have just listed few of them. First thing is your crystallite size and strain. So this we will try to cover here. Okay, so for example, if you go from micron size, so your blue color is your micron size or bulk CO2, cerium oxide. Okay, and if you make the same cerium oxide in nano form, nano crystals, then what happens? This peak is going to get broadened. Okay, but this kind of peak broadening can be even also due to some instrument parameter. Instead of using very thin slits, if I'm using very big slits, then again I can get this kind of broadening from the same sample. Okay, so these two scans are done on the same sample. Okay, but only thing is they have changed the slits. In for blue they have used very narrow slits, for red they have used bigger slits. So you cannot always say it is just because of your sample. You should know the history of your sample and also the instrument. Okay, so apart from that, you can also get phase and crystallinity of amorphous. For example, some people were asking polymers. So polymers, what you can get? You can get the even within the amorphous, there is different kinds of crystallinity you can achieve. So those things you can get from your XRD. Okay, so for that you have to do very well or very well systematic X-ray diffraction data collection. Okay, so next one is thin films. With respect to thin films, someone asked about GA XRD. So that is one more thing where GAXRD, the reason why you are doing GAXRD is you will have a lot of when you grow a film, you take a substrate. So substrate is normally very high crystalline substrate, like your silicon substrate or something like that, which is very good or very high crystalline. And you are trying to deposit some very thin layers, like in nanometers. So when you take this thin film under your X-ray diffractometer, what happens is you get signal from your material which is deposited, and also you get signal from your substrate. So as substrate is highly crystalline, you will not see the peak from your sample. Instead, you will see only the from the substrate. So that is the one reason why you go for GAXRD. So that again, if someone is interested, I can later explain. The other one is reflectance, to know the roughness and thickness of thin films. Okay, and there is something called as residual scattering. So this is mainly done on metals. So you take a metal piece, you do XRD, you get some peak, something like blue here. Okay, then you apply the load, maybe some 1 kg or 2 kg load. You apply the load, you do again XRD, then what happens, this peak is going to change. Okay, the shape of this peak is going to change. That is mainly due to the stress which is applied on the your metal. So when you apply some stress on the metal, your atomic arrangement is changed. Okay, it can either improve. For example, if you're doing some high temperature treatment, then you are going to improve the crystallinity, you are going to improve the arrangement of atoms. But if you are doing other way, if you are trying to put some pressure, then what happens, you may be destroying the arrangement of atoms. That means they may get scattered. So that then what happens, you will get broadening of your peak. Okay, so the last one is scattering, because apart from just diffraction, your material can also scatter the X-rays. So from using that information, you can also get what we call as SACS, small angle X-ray scattering. So this will give more information about the morphology of the particles. Okay, I will tell why that is the reason. Okay, and then PDF analysis, pair distribution function. So this is also again a scattering technique which is used. So these things are also done using a X-ray diffractometer. Okay, so this is one example where what happens with decreasing crystallite size. Okay, so if you take very high crystalline titanium oxide, you will see peaks are very well defined. Okay, and they are very sharp, and also each one are well separated. But if you decrease your crystallite size, then what happens when you go from micron size to nano size? Then what happens, these peaks will start broadening, and also they will lose the crystallinity. Okay, so you can see all these peaks, they are becoming very broad. So this three distinct peaks started looking like two or one here, okay, as you decrease the crystallite size. So this is one of the reason, but you should be very careful. The reason is, as I told, this kind of broadening can be also due to the strain. Okay, the strain, and also it can be also due to the your instrument. Okay, so for this, what you are supposed to do, you should do the experiment on the same instrument with the same settings. Okay, so best thing is, for example, if I want to study nanoparticles, so first what I should do, I should take a highly crystalline sample of my composition, then study the X-ray diffraction of it. So this will give the broadening. This broadening, whatever you get, is due to instrument. Means whatever slits you are using, due to the slits width, you get this broadening. Okay, then with the same setting, you try to collect the data for your nano particles. Then what happens? You have a reference which will give the broadening of your instrument. And then what you can do some calculation, which is your Scherer formula. Okay, so this is a Scherer formula. So I will again come back to it. So this broadening, in general, it is the total broadening of a peak is due to the instrument and also due to sample. Okay, again, it depends on which kind of fitting what is that peak shape you're using. Okay, so if you're using a Gaussian, then it is like this, and if you are using a Lorentzian, then the total broadening would be with a different equation. Okay, so now they also wanted to know the strain. Okay, so if you take the first picture, this is like you have layers of atoms, so then this becomes a crystal, right? So it can be a tiny crystal or big crystal. So in crystal, all the layers are arranged very systematically. So if you do this X-ray diffraction, you get some peak at some position. Like for example, I'm getting a peak here, right? So this black one is the peak which I get from the unstrained crystalline, okay, or which is very ideal crystalline sample. But if I induce some strain within the within this lattice, then what happens? There can be different types of strains. The first one is compressive strain, where you have tried to decrease the distance between each layers. So in that case, what happens? There is possibility the peak is going to shift. So this is shown here. Okay, so this shift can be due to this kind of compressive strains. So there is one more strain, which is inhomogeneous strain. Okay, so if you have some foreign particle in your crystal, then that will give some defects. So these defects would be propagating throughout the lattice, so which means throughout your entire crystal. So when you look into this kind of diffraction, then instead of sharp peak like this black one, you will get a broad peak. So this broadening can be again due to this kind of strain in a crystal. So if you take so there is one more example which you can see here. So if you take some SNO2, so I have given reference here, you can go through this. So again, same thing with size, change in size, they can see broadening. At the same time, they have induced some kind of this kind of stress, okay, or a strain in this in the crystal by doping some secondary element. Okay, so instead of ZnO2, they have doped some titanium into the Zn. Okay, so in that case, what happens? This titania will induce some crystallite size strain, and due to that, you get again some peak broadening. Okay, so these things are possible. So if you take the broadening of peaks, you cannot just say it is just only because of change in crystallized size, or you cannot say it is just due to your stress, okay, or strain. So again, this is just for your information. So if you take your XRD, your regular XRD, which we call it as wide angle X-ray, WRD, okay, wide angle X-ray diffraction, then you get information about the arrangement of your layers of atoms. Okay, but if you take the scattering, which is at very, very low angle, this would give more information about the entire part, this crystallites. Okay, so how the particle is formed. So that is the reason, this is a major difference between SACS and XRD. So in SACS, you are not using, you are taking the scattered data, not the diffracted data. So someone asked, what is the difference between crystallite size, grain size, particle size? Okay, so this is a very general relation. So your crystallite size is very, very small compared to grain size, and your grain size is small, lesser than or equal to particle size. Okay, so if you see here, for example, so each of this small thing is a, sorry, this entire circle is a particle, but if you take this arrangement, this is a grain. Okay, so this grain can also have lot of small crystals like your crystallites. So this crystallites would be much smaller compared to your grains, and then grains are much smaller to compared to your particles. Okay, sometimes it is possible that your crystallized size is equal to grains, and in some other case it will be grain size will be almost equal to your particle size. Okay, so but this is not you cannot have a very general or very general statement on this. So it is slightly difficult. You should be careful with when you are using crystallized size, particle size, grain size. So these are the things you need to take care of. Okay, so again, so these are the things what can these are the other things which can be due to which can lead to the broadening. Okay, the peak broadening. So the peak broadening can be due to crystallized size that we tried to explain in the previous one. It can be also due to microstrain, as we saw in the previous case. It can be also due to solid solution inhomogeneity and also temperature factor. Okay, but if I want to find the crystallized size, then I'm going to use some equation which is known as your Scherer formula. Okay, so I think you people have already used this. So it is given as B 2 theta is equal to K lambda by L into cos theta. Okay, your L is your crystallized size, B actually is your full width effect. Okay, so I will explain in detail. Okay, so this is your Scherer formula, K lambda by L cos theta. So K is your shape constant. Okay, so normally your Scherer constant, so this would be 9. This can vary between 0.62 to 2.08, but normally what happens, most common values that you can take for K is 0.94 for spherical crystals. So if it is a spherical crystal, then you can go for 0.94, and if it is something like spherical with cubic symmetry or without cubic symmetry, then it should be 0.89. Without cubic symmetry means if you are trying to find crystallized size for a tetragonal orthorhombic crystal. So if you are trying to find crystallized for a cubic crystal like CuO2, then you can use 0.94. But if you are doing this for non-cubic, like your TiO2, for example, which is a tetragonal, then you should use 0.89. okay, so these are some of the things you should take care when you are doing the crystallized size. Okay, so this anyhow, it's a lot of things. So there is one drawback of your Scherer formula. In this case, what happens, all the broadening whatever you are taking, you consider that to be only because of size effect. Okay, so you tell your broadening is mainly due to your size effect, but it can also be due to the stress, okay, or strain that I explained in the previous session. Okay, so if there is any contribution of the strain in the sample, then my crystallized size, whatever I'm using to or whatever I'm calculating here using a Scherer formula, this is going this is not accurate. Okay, it is not accurate in this case. So how to get more accurate is there is some other plot which we call as William Hall plot. Okay, so there is a reference here. So this William Hall plot, what it does is it will take into account both the broadening. Okay, the first one is your size broadening, which is your Scherer formula. The second one is your microstrain broadening. So you can always calculate these two separately using these two formulas. Okay, this formula will give crystallized size. The second formula will give your microstrain broadening. But if I want to consider both, then in that case, what happens? I have to go for William Hall plot. Okay, again, there is so much advance in this William Hall plot. So recently, I have given this reference. So if you go to this reference, the same William Hall plot for the same data, for the same sample. So you have to just collect one time data. So you are going to collect the data for your high crystalline sample, like your micron size sample. Then you collect data for your nanoparticles or nanostructures or whatever it is. Then you can use that data to do all this kind of modeling. Okay, so it is not very straightforward, but if you want to do size broadening and strain broadening studies, better go for William Hall plot. Okay, William Hall plot is better compared to your just only Scherer formula or just your microstrain formula. Okay, so this is your combination, and then in this case, what happens? You would get some points like this. Okay, so this is, you can write this as y is equal to mx plus c. It's a straight line. So if you have this y is equal to mx plus c, then if you plot this kind of graph, and if you try to do a fit, then what happens is your slope would give your strain factor, and your intercept would give your size factor. Okay, so for example, if you are having nanoparticles which there is no strain, then the slope would be almost zero. That means it will become very straight line. So you can say, okay, there is no strain in this sample. For example, if you are trying to do strain on a microstructural particles, so in a micron size particle, the size effect would be zero, because in that case your y-intercept would be almost zero. So if I get y-intercept as zero, that means I can say there is no size effect. Okay, and if I get some slope equals almost equal to zero, then I can say there is no strain effect. So this is more accurate compared to just using your Scherer formula or your microstrain formula. Okay, so this is something what I wanted to tell. So this is your, again, microstrain formula you use. And then this is the solid state inhomogeneity. So for example, if you're trying to do cerium oxide and zirconium oxide solid solution, then it is difficult because both are in different size form. So you cannot do size effect. Okay. So with this, I think I will stop here, and I will take some questions. So again, after that, I will do one more problem for two-phase ritual refinement. So if you have any question, I can take.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Hello.
Sir, there are no questions in the chat box.
Okay. So then it's fine. So what exactly I will do is, I will provide you some Excel sheet where you can just use this kind of formula. Okay, so if you can either use this size broadening effect, or you can use just strain broadening effect, or you can also apply the William Hall plot. So I will provide you, because I have to prepare that, I will prepare and provide. So the reason why I showed you how to get this FWHM is, this is the FWHM which you are going to apply in this case. Okay, so if I want to have this B specimen, this is nothing but your broadening. Okay, the FWHM will come from this kind of calculation. Okay, so normally what people will do is, they will take their X-ray diffraction pattern, they will feed it into your Origin or any software. They will try to do find some maybe I'll just find the I may check. Okay, I'll just check what I can do. Origin. I will show what most of the people will do.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sorry for interrupting you. A few participants has posted some questions. Can I read it for you?
Yes. You can. We can go. We can go ahead.
One question from Anjali Jose. Sir, WH plot has negative slope possible. If yes, why?
Negative slope means you can see from the, you should analyze from this. So what is the meaning of negative slope? That means your strain is negative strain. So this happens when you are doing micron size particles. Okay. So in some cases, you can also have this for nanoparticles, but in that case you should be careful. You should try other possibilities. You try to get strain from this equation, size from the other equation, like your Scherer formula. You use the Scherer formula for size, and then you can also use your strain formula for getting your strain, okay, and then you can try to correlate if you can have something. So these kind of things are like not the basic information, but these are like supplementary information that you can get from a X-ray diffraction. So you should be very careful when you do this kind of analysis. Okay, so yes, you can ask for next question.
Okay, sir. Next question from Krishna. In multiphase data, sometimes there are 2 to 3 shoulders in a peak due to overlapping of peaks, and hard to evaluate number of peak manually. How to accurately calculate number of peaks? Is there any software for that which can help?
Can you please again read it, ma'am?
Okay, sir. In multiphase data, sometimes there are 2 to 3 shoulders in a peak due to overlapping of peaks, and hard to evaluate number of peak manually. How to accurately calculate number of peaks? Is there any software for that which can help?
Software, I think you can go with WinPlotter. You can do it. But what I would suggest is, if that is the case, then you should take smaller steps. So you, if you're taking smaller steps, that would help you to actually deconvolute the peaks very well. Instead of just doing fitting, because you don't know, because if you're using K alpha 1 and alpha 2, then your life will be much more difficult, because each peak would give two peaks, and if there are 3-4 peaks in very narrow range, then it would be very difficult to deconvolute, whether you use any software or whatever. So best thing in that case is go for smaller step size. So only take those, you don't have to take entire range. So if you are having some peak overlapping between 22 to 25, you just do the smallest step possible. Okay, you just scan it only in that range. So that would be a better solution.
Okay, can I read next question?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Question from Debu Joseph. Difference between use of Scherer and Debye-Scherer formula?
Debye-Scherer, I think, is the same, I think. I don't know. I have to check it, because I am not this one. So I will check it.
Okay, sir. Next question from Ammu Vijay. You provide a video for finding bond angle and bond length determination using full prof?
Yes, yes. So you see, right now actually I have already, like, we have already all the data. So you have to just go here. This is a bond strength calculator. Okay, so this is already built in there. So what you are supposed to do is, you have to just import here. You import your SIF file. Okay, so this SIF file, you can use the SIF file for plotting your crystal structure. Okay, so just a minute. So once you get this SIF file from your refinement, you just plug in here, and then you just click this save, and then you run it. Okay, so it will already give all your information here. Okay, so these things can be used to if you want to give in your so yeah, I think I will provide you a separate one. So I think I will give you in a very detailed one. Okay, so you can, once you do very good refinement, you can extract a lot of information, like your crystal structure, and also if you have VESTA, then you can also find the distance between two, your bond angle and bond length, all those things you can get it. Okay, so unfortunately I don't have right now VESTA. If I had VESTA, then I could show you how to calculate the bond distance. Okay, so yes, I can take the next one.
Okay, sir. Next question from Bishop Moore College. If a sample have considerable strain, what could be its order?
Strain, again, this is in percentage. So whatever you get in this formula that I was talking, so whatever you get, this is a percentage. Okay, so this again, it depends on your so you can see here, epsilon is your strain. Okay, so this is delta D by D. So if you do this calculation, you get it in percentage. So this can vary, I don't know, maybe up to some, maybe 3%, 4%, or what, 3-4% is already you're destroying the crystal. But I don't know, you have to check. So this you get it from this data. Okay, so if you do this calculation, so your epsilon will come this side, okay? And then this is your broadening actually. B2 theta is the size, your full width half maxima. Okay, so whatever full width half maxima you take in for your peak, okay? So in this case, this is your B2 theta. Then you can calculate the epsilon, okay? So this epsilon will give, it will be in some percentage. Okay? So you can calculate that. From your, either you can calculate individually by using this microstrain broadening, or you can just use this William Hall plot. Okay, so if you use a William Hall plot, you can again get the strain here. This will be in the percentage.
Okay, can I read the next question?
Yes.
From Kalpana Nagde, would you please elaborate with example for crystallite size and strain?
Yes, okay. So crystallite size and strain, I will again come back, because I think what I wanted to do is so we have already done this, right? So we have done this FWHM calculation. So this FWHM calculation is from your ritual refinement, okay? So you can use this FWHM, and then you can use your 2 theta. So if you are talking about purely your Schroeder equation, so what you need is L. L is your crystallite size. B2 theta is your FWHM, okay? So let us assume this is a spherical particle, it is a cubic. So in that case, I am going to use K is equal to 0.94, okay? Then lambda is constant, 1.54. Then what you do is you take the highest intensity peaks, okay? So you can see here, the intensity is given here, which is in some thousands, right? So you can take these peaks, the position is given here, 2 theta, and then this is your FWHM, okay? And one thing you should make sure is that your FWHM should not vary too much. If it is varying too much, then what happens? That means you are having inhomogeneous distribution, or maybe your fitting is not good, okay? So this is the reason why I asked you to do this kind of exercise, okay? Lot of people, what they do, they use origin. They will find what is the height, what is the base. Sometimes even they don't see the base. They will take the full width, they will try to find the half width at the mid of the peak. So that is not exactly good, okay? So if you see here, this is very nice. If you see this variation, at least for high intense peak, so this is your high intense peak. So the next is this one. And if you see the full width half maxima, it is almost constant. So if you use this equation for finding your crystallite size, it is easy, or it is more accurate. So what you can do, I will provide you a Excel sheet where you just copy and paste this full width half maxima and 2 theta. Okay. Once you copy paste this, you should get your crystallite size. Okay. So that is what I am going to send you. Okay. I will make that and I will send you. Because some people, I think even I feel like I will repeat one repetition for maybe two phase. If I have two phase, so what? How to do the ritual refinement? Okay. Once you have ritual refinement, you can extract a lot of data. So you can, even if you're with variation of sizes, you can just publish with only X-ray diffraction. Okay. So you take X-ray diffraction, you calculate your crystallite size, you calculate your strain, you calculate the your crystal structure, you calculate your bond angle, bond length. Okay. So if you do all those things, that is sufficient to make a really good paper. So that is how you can do with this ritual refinement.
Okay, sir. Sir, can we discuss the questions after this session? Because yes, more and more questions are being coming. So
okay. Yes. So what do you want to do? Can we take a break, or I think we will take a break because yes, maybe some 10 minutes break or 15 minutes break. Then I will again start because I already put so many things into this seminar last 1 hour. So even I feel like participant may get lost. So better we will take some 15 minutes break and then we will join again. I will go. I will do this multiphase. Okay. So I will start with multiphase profile fit. Then again, I will introduce the ritual fit. Okay. Then I will also get those HKL whatever I showed you. Okay. That can be used for doing the crystallized size strain calculation. Is it fine?
Okay, sir. It's fine.
Okay.
Okay. Our participants, please note the session will restart after 15 minutes break. Thank you.